Then they go back to do the microbiology analysis. Okay, so that's why the risk is for that. And this is a guy. He's zero tolerance in non-intact beef. Including ground beef. Which means you're not allowed to have one single cell. And the death rate is very high, 5%. And the dose rate is also very low. 10 cells will cause a person die. It's very, very risky. And I want to tell you one thing, nobody really cares until this happens. You can search the Google just simply to see. This is the big news. 1993 in Seattle Jack in Box, because of the undercooked hamburger, they killed 4 kids and 171 people hospitalized, 45 infected, 4 of them are dying. And the lawsuit is still going on. I tell you, it hasn't finished yet either. Why? Just because the hamburger is undercooked. So how they should cook? You should cook the internal temperature of a beef products. Go to 160 degrees Fahrenheit, 71.1 degrees Celsius. It based on the USDA FSIS guidance will be roughly killing E. coli 015-7H7. I want to emphasize this is the key. What is that means internal? Geometric center. It is not surface. This is the stuff lots of people don't understand. You need to have some of the portable meter inserted into the geometric center to measure the temperature. Is rich 160 degrees Fahrenheit, 71.1 degrees Celsius. It's not the surface. This is not you using scanning thermometer, you just deep and then you see your forehead. No. You can just use a scanning surface on the surface of the cooked beef and say, oh, it's good. No. The thermal carbon has to be inserted into the geometric center to make sure they reach 160 degrees Fahrenheit. But why people always eat undercooked beef? Think about this is we call it a palatability or we call it a quality. For the beef, what do we care about? Juiciness, flavor, and tenderness. This is the reason you go to order a beef steaks, you will say medium well done, or well done, or long. And there's a survey showing 80% of the United States person like to order a medium well done steaks because it's very tender. You slide your mouth, you eat a tough. If the beef you cook about 75 degrees Celsius, it's like a stone. You can't even bite it. And this one gave you a very good feeling about tenderness and also the juiciness, where they come from. Come from intramuscular fat. That's the juiciness. Okay, so that's why it causes a big topic, big risk, because lots of people they order from medium well done or even low. And then that's cause a problem. But they do have a guidance which is telling you 71.1 degrees Celsius internal temperature. This is a really big risk. I tell you one thing. They touched the nerve of the White House by the time. And Bill Clinton is the president, Al Gore is the vice president. They have the Congress emergency meeting to solve the food safety issue in the United States. What they do? This is what comes out. HACCP. You always heard about some food products is HACCP certified. Some company is HACCP certified. This HACCP, that HACCP. What is that? hazard analysis critical control points. This is what we want to introduce you a little bit. We want to go very deep. That could be a topic, teach a whole semester, an individual class, talk about microbial safety and hazard. So what is hazard? A preventive control system. That's a proactive control system. But this does not mean food safety. Now where it comes from? NASA comes from the Pillsbury Company in 1959. At the beginning, the astronauts go to the space, they need to have very safe food. Because in the food, in the space, you cannot have any outbreaks. If there's outbreaks, no one can save you. So their food, of course, it's certified and make sure it is safe. That's why they developed the plan, is called HAZAR. And they have to do is a hazard analysis. That is encoding from the food products, the processing, handling, storage, packaging, distribution. You can say very simple, it is from farm to table to cover the whole area. So what is a hazard? Okay, hazard analysis critical control points have seven principles. Number one, conduct a hazard analysis. What is a hazard analysis? It could be biological, physical, and chemical. Now, in this class, what we folks talk about is bacteria, biological hazards. This is most of the hazard covered. Number two, establish a critical control point. What is a critical control point? A step at which control can be applied to make sure the hazards is demolished or reduced to the level which is accepted by the federal regulation. That's called critical control points. Now, every critical control point needs to be establish a certain critical limit. So, for example, when you're cooking a steak, the critical control points, obviously, is cooking. That's a critical control point. Then how do we make sure it is roughly cooked? We need to set up a critical limit. That is usually a parameter of a physical and a chemical indexes corresponding to the critical control points. That is called critical limits. So here, the critical limits, 71.1 degrees Celsius. Be careful, the critical limits in hazard plan has to be a fixed number, cannot be a range. Okay, this is very strict. You cannot be a range, that has to be a fixed number. Under FSMA regulation, it could be a range, it's different. We'll talk about FSMA real quick. Establish monitoring procedures. So what means the monitoring procedures? I have this cooking steps, which is a critical control points. I set up a critical limits of this internal temperature 160 degrees Fahrenheit. I have to do some monitoring procedure to make sure you did it right. Including you rarely tested the internal temperature during the cooking. Including the thermometer is calibrated. Including when you cooked it, you recorded it, you did it. All those type of things is need a person to do the monitoring. The monitoring person, most of the time, is a person working on the processing line. It's not really the supervisor. Because if there is a third-party audit, the supervisor has to accompany with the person. So usually it's a person working in the line, in the processing line, so monitoring procedure. Establish corrective action. always corrective action. If there is a deviation happens, which means they failed to reach control the critical control points or critical control limits, you need to do something to correct it. That's called corrective actions. So for example, if you're cooking, your internal temperature is only 70 degrees Celsius, then you should say, stop it. Those products cannot go to the commercial markets because they may have a risk. So what we should do? We need, you can go back to recooking. Yes, but that has to be verified first. What else we can do? You disregard them, you throw them away, go to the garbage can. You cannot go to the market. Or what do we do? Become a pet foods. And another example, if the ground beef has been contaminated with E. coli 157H7 during the cold storage, what they do? They further cook and become ready to eat meat. So that's the reason most of your hot dogs is actually from contaminated ground beef. There's a survey said 70-80% of the hot dog in the United States is coming from the contaminated ground beef. So that's a good corrective actions. Now sometimes you see some other terminology, they say it's a correction. Not said corrective action, they say it's a correction. Correction is different. So for example, in the morning you go to a plant. You see the bench is not clean. They forget to do the sanitizing yesterday. So you say, before we process it, can we do a cleaning and a sanitizing or we redo it? That's called a correction. It's usually a minor point. You can fix it immediately. But corrective actions, which means something you failed to reach. And you have to do something to fix it. And that has to be fixed is routine, is permanently, is not temporary. Okay, so that's a corrective action. Establish verification procedure. Okay, I did everything. I established a critical control points. I set up a critical limits. I have a person to do the monitoring. I also have a corrective actions. I need to verify this whole process is working. And I usually need a person to do the audits and the verification. That is called a verification. This is sometimes is by done by third party agent. Some service company can do that. That's called a verification. Last thing, very important, record keeping and documentation. This means everything you have to be documented. They have a lots of those called data log. Temperature data log, pH data log, water activity data log, product name, address, company name, details. That's called a record keeping and documentation. Very important for seven principles. They listed exactly in this Federal Register. This is published in 1996 by Department of Agriculture, Food Safety and Inspection Service. 300 pages require all the poultry meat and the meat products company in the United States must establish a hazard plan. Of course, they started it, which is a large establishment, then become a medium establishment, small establishments, the very small establishments. The very small establishments, they can be due like 4 years later in 2000, if I remember. And I want to tell you something. This document is very interesting. This whole hazard is coming from E. coli 0157H7. But if you go to online to read this document, this pathogen control you see there, they are talking about the control salmonella. And the whole procedure, they have some other attachment to it, amendments to it. They never mention about 0157H7, they are talking about is a wild type E. coli, which is a surrogate. So it's very ironically and very interesting. But nevertheless, HACCP has become a very good principle as a proactive way to control foodborne pathogens, although it does not necessarily mean food safety. However, even you do that, you still have something going to happen. If you read the news today, it's always happening. E. coli 1577. 12 million kilogram ground beef happened in 1997. Beef trimming and ground beef, 9 million kilogram, happened in 2002. And the mechanic tenderized injected beef in 2007. So they all has contaminated. So they have to issue a recall. Okay, there are basically three types of the recall we have to introduce a little bit. Recall, which means the products have to stop there, cannot go to the commercial supply chain. Because when you get it, you get sick. What are the three types of the recall, three level? Number one, pathogen. If you have a pathogen, you have to recall. Absolutely. Second level, allergy. Allergy. So fish, egg, peanuts, allergy. Sometimes you cannot have it. Number three, mislabel. Those are three levels of the recall. So they have to have a recall plan, most of the company. Okay, it's keep happening. What are we gonna do? This is really relatively new. Started from 2012. Not only E. coli 0157H7, not 0157 Shigella toxin generally E. coli, including 2026, 0111, 0103, 0121, 045, 0145. We gave them a nickname called Big Six. And these big six Shigella toxin, now 0157H7, has to be encoded in the testing of these products. Which means not only E. coli 0157H7, these other non 0157 Shigella toxin E. coli has to be zero tolerance, which means no single cell in your products. Because these are still hemorrhagic E. coli, they will still cause HUS, they still could kill people. So by the time, in 2012, they started to have a big research area for developing rapid testing methods for E. coli 0157H7, including non-0157 Big Six STEC. There is a nickname at the time in the food safety area called the USA. Universal STAC analysis. It's just a nickname. People go there, food safety conference, they always say, and I remember one person is wearing a t-shirt that said the USA. It's not a patriot, because it's for the universal STAC analysis. And by the time those big six testing, develop a rapid testing methods is an emergency. Because you know that you cannot rely on traditional microbiology analysis. It took a lot of time. Think about you have a bacteria plated on McConkey agar. You prepare on Tuesday, you're gonna see the results on Thursday, is that right? For the company, they cannot do that. They need to know the results as soon as possible, sometimes within a half day or even a couple of hours. So those rapid testing methods is developed dramatically by time. So this is a story for meat safety. But there is something I want to mention. HACCP is not covered fresh produce. You go to the USDA FSIS website, there is a generic model for HACCP. And I believe some of you, or like three or five students in the whole classroom, couple of years later could work in those companies or work in those testing labs. There are lots of generic E. coli, generic HACCP model for beef, for pork, for poultry, for lamb, for the other things, but non-intact beef, but never you're gonna see anything for fresh produce. And even juice you have it. Even milk you have it, but not for fresh produce. Because we always think fresh produce is safe. Remember, we always eat a lot of fresh produce. Have a bag from Kroger, put some dressing there, that's your lunch. However, this thing happened. 2006 in Salinas, Central Valley, California. And fresh spinach find contaminated E. coli 0157H7 colonies. Caused 200 people. Involved 26 states. Even one in West Virginia. 51% hospitalized. 3 deaths. That's not good. Where is fresh produce happened right here? Central Valley of California, you have Taylor Farms, Fresh Express, and Dole. You go markets, you buy back fresh produce, Fresh Express, Dole, or Taylor Farms. Some of the local company in West Virginia, they have it, but that's a big places for fresh produce safety. Another big area, Yuma, Arizona. Where's the other one? Florida. Especially tomatoes. That's the reason it becomes a risk. It is the first time people isolated E. coli 0157H7 in a bad fresh produce or a spinach. Therefore, people trying to do something, they come out with the idea of another regulation called the FSMA. Unfortunately, this really bad happens again. This is 2011 in Colorado, which is cantaloupe, related to Listeria monocytogenes from Jason Farms. Almost 70% of the United States involved in these outbreaks. How many people dead? 33 people dead. And I said at the beginning, very ironically, the Jason Farms have a third party validation inspection. They get a 95 points, which is excellent. A couple of days later, this outbreak happened, and they go to the farm to do the inspection. It's really horrible. It did for the sanitation. That's why the sanitation is important to control this terminal pathogens. But cantaloupe is difficult. Why? Cantaloupe's surface is not smooth. Is that right? We have those rind area. Those are the niche area. What type of the bacteria will be there? Biofilms. So it's difficult to control. If you do not do a good job of sanitizing, the biofilm will be there. So it will be 10 times, 100 times resistant to antimicrobials. So that's one of the issues. The sanitizing, if you failed, that's not good. So right now, we have a new regulation called the FSMA, Food Safety Modernization Act. There is basically 7 rules for that. But we don't care about a lot of the others. We care about is produce safety rule and the preventive control rules. This second one is basically copy or pattern. The only thing what they emphasize is they add a major components, emphasize the risk of allergy. And they need to develop a very detailed recall plan. And we always do these training because I'm also an extension specialist with the state. So I gave several talks about preventive controls. I will give one very soon on November 28th in the afternoon. And I can send you guys a link. If you're interested, you can listen to the talk. It's very interesting. We talk about preventive controls from an industry standpoint. FSMA signed into law by President Obama in January 4th, 2011. But they gave a flexible for the companies to establish. So after this one into the rule, everything is become very busy. Every extension specialist in the United States is trying to do the training for all those industry persons. However, it gives flexible. They gave flexible for small farms. If your 3-year average sales is less than 500,000, or your distribution is within 275 miles, and all your final major distribution is directly to the consumers, restaurants, it is waived for the FSMA regulation. Who is the beneficial bidder for this one? All the farmers at West Virginia. We had a small farm conference center here. Because we are small farms. Based on this regulation, if you grow something in Morgantown, you sell at Charleston, within 275 miles, you wait. But I tell you, lots of the small farmers, they still do because they want to make sure they have high credibility for the food safety. But I do tell you, when FSMA have a regulation, a flexible for small farmers. So what they should do? We have another regulation coming. But this is really is a suggestion. Instead of we call it a regulation, it's really a suggestion. We call it a gap. Not the commercial products gap. Okay. What is called? Good agriculture practices. This is usually we say it's a comprehensive system to reducing foodborne illness spread primarily by the microbes. It is not really targeted for safety. It is for quality assurance. So you can see the line there. It's from before planting, during production, during harvesting, and post-harvesting. And we do have a regulation documents for that. This is guideline to minimize microbial safety for fresh fruits and vegetables. Although it's only almost 27 years, that's still the guideline for the GAP today. Not very heavy, about like 75 pages, you can read it. Tedious, lots of things you're going to talk about. What that really talk about? The GAP have four major items. Safe soil. What this means? This basically means the manure and the compost have to be controlled. You can do fresh manure. The manure has to be there 24 hours at least. Fresh manure you have, animal poop, fecal contamination. Not good. That's safe soil. Number two, clean water. Why it is important? Did we do an APC petrofilm and the E. coli petrofilm in the lab? We did that. Zero tolerance for fecal coliform. What's the difference between coliform and the fecal coliform? Fecal coliform incubate 44.5 degrees Celsius. Coliform 35 degrees Celsius. That's the only difference. Clean water, no fecal coliform. Clean surfaces. What does clean surfaces mean? Control biofilm. You need to make sure the biofilm is well controlled. That's a matter.